Welcome to the next lecture on balances as guides towards a sustainable future. Last time we have dealt with balances, how to set them up, how to utilize them, and we have learned that the global average temperature stems more or less from a balance for radiation coming in from the sun and leaving the earth by its own radiation. And we saw how, for example, greenhouse gases have an effect on that and how we can see that from the balances. Today we want to deal with the question, where are we today? And that is to set up the basis then to ask where we will be developing into the future, which is then followed up in the next presentations. So today the question is, where are we today? What do we have available? How much are we using it? Just to get a feeling for that. Before I go into that, I first have to set up some or give some definitions. They are given here and I read them so that you can follow them. Reserves are geologically and technically proven amounts of crude oil, coal, natural gas and so on, which can be extracted economically with the technologies available today. This means we know it is there, we have the technology to extract it from the ground, and these processes are economically feasible. This is, it works today. In contrast to that, resources in this strict sense are amount of a raw material, the technical and economical extraction of which is still uncertain, which can nevertheless be expected based on geological indicators. So there are some indications, we don't know exactly, but there are some indications that the raw material is there, well, might be there, should be there perhaps, according to our experience. That extraction is uncertain, we still hope it is possible, we don't know if it is economical, and we expect to have the technologies available sometime, or possibly they are also available today. We don't know, it's still uncertain. Now, of course, if we talk about resources and reserves, and if we want to set up balances, it's obvious that we can't use resources in this strict sense to set up balances, because that are only estimates, that can't be real strict numbers. And if you want to solve balances quantitatively, we still have to, or simply have to, stick to reserves. So I will be talking most of the time about reserves. Well, sometimes I'm also talking about resources, but in most cases I don't use this term in this strict sense, but I rather talk about reserves at what is generally available to our, well, good that we can use, meaning fossil energy carriers, meaning land area, meaning sunlight. These are the resources that we have to live on. So in this more or less colloquial sense, I'm very often using the term resources. And strictly speaking, when I set up the balances, I'm talking about reserves. Okay, now once we have defined the definition of reserves and resources in the strict sense, we can proceed and look at the numbers that we have. And the numbers are given here. Reserves for crude oil, we have 225 gigatons, natural gas 154 gigatons, and coal 860 gigatons. A gigaton is 10 to the 9th ton, 1 billion tons. Actually, a gigaton is a kilometer times a kilometer times a kilometer, a cube of 1 kilometer side length filled with water. That's a gigaton. Actually, I can't imagine how much that is. I don't have any feeling about the size and the magnitude of this cube filled with water. And of that, we actually have 225. This is beyond the scope of my imagination. Same, of course, with the other resources. So I can't do anything with that. And even if I look for the consumption, which is 4.1 gigatons per year of crude oil, I can't imagine that either. It's still a big number. Or also electricity, 22 petawatt hours per year. Peta means 10 to the 15th. So 22 times 10 to the 15th watt hours per year. I can't imagine that. I don't have any feeling how much that could be. So the question is there a way to make it imaginable to grasp the numbers that we have at hand and compare them to something that we can experience in everyday life. And I'll try that by relating those big numbers to the number of people in the world. By doing that, I take the world average, that is what everybody of us has available as reserves, and how much everybody of us is using on the global average. Well, I should say something about the numbers I'm giving in general. They are not of today. They are usually dating some years back, in the range somewhere between 2008 and say 2011 or so. The reason for that is, for example, we get information about food production only dated back, or the latest data are on 2009. Energy data you usually find 2 years back, population data possibly only 1 year back. So in order to really have a comparable set of data, you have to go back to a time period somewhere 4 or 5 years, meaning that we have to take the data somewhere in a time span between 2008 and 2010 mostly, in order to get a comparable data set. Okay, we see that we have 7 billion people at that time, roughly 7,6970 million people. In Austria, where I'm living, we have 8 million, roughly 8 million people. In Germany, 80 million people, and so on. This is not all nations and not all regions, apparently, but some I have chosen. For example, in the European Union, we have 500 million people. In the US, we have 300 million people. Africa, 1 billion people. China, 1.4 roughly billion people. And India, 1.25 billion people. Especially in India and Africa, these numbers are continually significantly increasing. In China, it's more or less became stable. This means actually that almost every fifth person on this earth is Chinese, and today presumably also every fifth person is an Indian. Yeah? And all the others are making only up three-fifths of the population, the rest, so to speak. Okay, now I want to relate the numbers I've shown before to these 7 billion people. If I do so, I wind up with these numbers, and they become significantly smaller, apparently. Per person, we have 32 tons crude oil available, 22 tons of natural gas, 122 tons of coal. Overall, 177 fossil energy carriers that we have available per person. Let's look at the number of 122. Can we somehow grasp that? Can we understand how much that is? Well, a small wagon for coal for the railway takes roughly 15 tons. There are bigger ones, double and triple that, 30, almost 50 tons, no problem. You get big ones like that, but the small ones take 15 tons. So these are roughly 8 small wagons of coal. This is not much. And that is what I personally, on global average, have available of these reserves. This is not much. And of that, I'm using these numbers. Actually, I'm using a little bit more than one, I myself, a little bit more than 1 ton, 1,100 kilograms of coal per year. For natural gas, it's 342 kilograms, and for crude oil, 582 kilograms per person, each of us. Not only me, it's also you. Also, you are using that much of the fossil resources that we have. Overall, roughly 2 tons per year. Actually, that can now be calculated also per day on a daily basis. You can see the individual numbers. Overall, it's 5.6 kilograms you use and I use every day on global average. On global average, of course, there are nations that are further developed and some that are less developed. And the numbers actually in developed countries are roughly double that. That means in the lesser developed countries, the numbers are significantly less than that per person. And this number actually always reminds me of what my parents told me when, or tell me when they were young, they were going to school. They always had to take pieces of coal to the school so that the school could be heated. Yeah? And it's something like this. In the morning, you take 5.6 kilograms of these fossil resources. Then they're used up over the entire day. And next day, this is gone. Next day, you have to come up with another 5.6 kilograms. It's just gone. It's converted to carbon dioxide, burned mostly. And from that, per day, we produce 13.4 kilograms of CO2 and then release that into the atmosphere. We burn it. We use the energy that is set free by this process and use it to get, well, either heating or electricity or transportation or whatever. So 5.6 kilograms for each of us per day. And we should remember that value because that will become relevant later on. If we look what we do with that, or how much that is energetically speaking, it's roughly 20,500 kilowatt hours per capita and year. And this is a number we should remember. It's important if you want to compare many other things. So 20,500 roughly kilowatt hours per capita and year. And developed countries usually have some values here of the order of 40 to 50,000 kilowatt hours per capita to year two. So 2 to 2.5 times that. And of course, lesser developed countries significantly less. We will see that in a moment. This is per day, 56 kilowatt hours per capita a day. This is relevant if you want to compare that to numbers where you use it for. For example, for a hot bath or something like that, that this number becomes relevant. 56 kilowatt hours per capita a day. We will see that later on in the very last presentation I will give in the last video. Electricity from that, we produce 3,200 kilowatt hours per capita and year on the average. And these are now numbers that you compare to something that you have around you. If you look at the electricity bill, for example, that you get every year, and look at it for your household, take the kilowatt hours that are represented there for those you are paying, and you take that, divide it by the number of people in your household, you will wind up with a number which is hopefully less than that. Hopefully. It depends on how you live, on your living style and other things. But of course, this is not only the electricity at home, this is all electricity produced, meaning all that is used in industry, for railway transportation, things like that. All that is included in here, the end, what all people do, so to speak, street lighting and everything. So we should remember this 20,500, we should remember kilowatt hours per capita and year, the 5.6 kilograms per capita and day, what we use of fossil resources overall. These are the numbers we use, and the nice thing is now by relating that to the people, to the number of people, the overall numbers to the number of people, it really, really relates to us. These are the numbers that relate to each of us individually. And living in a developed country, we know we use up 2 to 2.5 times that much. Okay. And we can compare that directly to numbers that are available to us. We can imagine 5.6 kilograms. That's something you can grasp. It's not just any big number. It's something you really can grasp. Even the 2 tons you can grasp of it for the entire year that you use for these fossil resources. Now, as I said, the utilization of these resources is not equally distributed across the world. And if you look at that in detail, we see now here the primary energy consumption per capita in 1,000 kilowatt hours per year and per person, plotted versus the population in billion. Well, all the nations for which the data are available have been sorted according to their per capita consumption of the overall primary energy carriers calculated in these 1,000 kilowatt hours per year. And we see on the world average a little bit more than 20,000, so 20 times 1,000 is 20,000, so this is the world average. The developed countries, especially Europe, United States, there are 40, this is Europe more or less, 40 to 50,000 kilowatt hours per year and per person. United States is significantly above that. Actually, one has to say this number is coming down pretty rapidly, where in Europe, well, it's decreasing also a little bit, but very slowly, actually. And the nice thing about this diagram is now that we can learn something about how much each nation contributes to the overall global energy consumption, world energy, primary energy consumption. And this is because if you look at such a square, for example, or not a square, a rectangle for China, for example, we can see that this is the population and this is the per capita consumption, meaning the consumption per person. So the area of this rectangle is this length times that length. This is the consumption per capita times the people, meaning times the number of heads in this nation. This means the overall area of this rectangle corresponds directly to the overall primary energy consumption in that nation, in that country. And there you can see that China and United States are those predominantly contributing to the overall global consumption. India, compared to that, is the area of this rectangle is rather small. But of course, as I said, in China, a fifth of the world population are living, so they of course get their share. Actually, they are more or less on the world average today. I mean, these data are from 2008. You can guess that today they are significantly above the world average, simply because their economy grew during the last years by roughly almost 10% per year. And that also means, of course, that their per capita energy consumption has been increasing significantly. That shifts on the one hand side the world average, but on the other hand side, of course, also the value for the nation itself. Okay, now the question, when we have seen how this really relates, how the different nations relate, we can see how the energy is being used. And we can discuss that a little bit in the following three diagrams. First of all, we want to look on the share each resource has for the overall energy contributions. There we see natural gas, coal and crude oil on this global scale contribute more than 3/4 of the overall primary energy consumption. Yeah, they have more or less a share of, well, not really equal size, but comparable size. Each of these contribute on a global scale on a comparable values. Hydropower is 2.2%, nuclear power almost 6%, biomass astonishingly 10%. When I saw this value the first time, I was really astonished about that. And the thing is that conventional biomass utilization is included in here. That is, in very many countries in Africa and South America, for example, people are collecting wood and heating with that and cooking with that. So this is included here, and overall, on a global scale, this corresponds to 10% of the energy that is being consumed by humans. Other renewables apparently, or mostly presumably, are 0.8%. So here we see how dependent we actually are with respect to the energy to fossil resources, resources that are being used up. Yeah? So this, of course, if you use them up, that can become a problem, apparently. So this is one way to look at energy. Next way to look at it is shown here. It's again the different resources that we have. Actually, it's for the United States, the energy flow chart from 2011. And you see, well, to scale the big ones, but the smaller ones are apparently not to scale. You see here geothermal is 0.226 in whichever units this are. Biomass is 4, and compared to petroleum, which is 35, coal 20, natural gas 25, and the others are actually pretty small. Also solar 0.158, it's a very small value. What you see now actually is how this is utilized, how this is distributed over the different ways we use it. This is the corresponds to the electricity generation, and this is the electricity coming out, and this is actually wasted in producing the electricity. So in conversion of towards electricity, a huge amount is actually wasted to produce this small amount of electricity. And what I've wanted to show actually here is this distribution here: transportation, industrial, commercial, and residential. Because if you look at those things, you might ask yourself, what is the distribution between these sectors where the energy is being used. Transportation, industrial, commercial and residential. This means heating more or less. This is industry, this is to move around. And actually, this value is pretty high in the United States. In Germany, for example, this contribution is significantly less than that as compared to the others. What I wanted to show is that these different sectors contribute on an equal scale to the overall energy consumption. Commercial is usually a little bit less, but the other three are more or less on an equal scale. Sometimes the residential is higher, sometimes it's less. As I said, in the United States, this is very high. If this is a little bit less, then they are even more equal in size. And I will show a little bit more about that, to detail about that a little bit in the next slide for Austria, because in Austria we have a very detailed bookkeeping where the energy is coming from and where it is going to. So there are very detailed values available. And I will first talk about the final energy, that is the energy as it is supplied before the last conversion step. And it's distributed according to where it comes from, crude oil, coal, natural gas. So also here we see a lot directly being used. Then we have already converted electricity, which is coming to a certain extent, for example, from a hydropower. Then renewables, 15.7% in Austria. This is lots of wood, for example, but also hydropower, as I said, and community heating, which is, so to speak, co-generated while you produce electricity. And actually, this is a very efficient way to produce heating for the people while you produce the energy. It's a very efficient way actually to convert your fossil raw material into electricity and heating power. Now this is again the final energy, but distributed a little bit differently. The traffic, it's 33.8%. Commercial, producing business, this is industry. And this is what was before called residential. This is what the households use. Agriculture is 2.1%. And here you see that traffic, producing business, and households have a really more or less equal share. It shifts a little bit, but it's of very similar size. Commercial is a little bit less. And if you want to use agriculture separately, it's an almost negligible contribution. Then in the next bar diagram, you see the effective energy. And this is really the energy that is used in the last step, or more or less after the last step. Room heating and air conditioning and transport are again the major contributions. But you also have other things like stationary motors, industrial furnaces, steam generation. And this is more or less all affiliated with industry and commercial things. Illumination and electronic devices is 2.9%. Now, why is this diagram of interest? If you see how much effort, for example, in Europe is produced in order to, or taken care of in order to reduce the electricity consumption for light bulbs by using modern techniques for light bulbs, you can see that you are tackling only 2.9% of the overall effective energy consumption, which means, of course, you are trying to reduce this very small amount. And it would be much more efficient, on the other hand side, to reduce the amount you use for transportation or for room heating and air conditioning. Here it's the insulation of the houses or very efficient air conditioning methods. Transportation, it's of course the efficiency of the motors. If you replace a car, a private car, which say uses 10 liters of gasoline per 100 kilometers by one which uses only 5 liters per 100 kilometers, which is available today, even they go down to almost, 3 point whatever liters per 100 kilometer, you can reduce this number quite significantly. And you can reduce that by insulating your houses also quite significantly. And this is much more efficient than putting all the effort into buying and replacing the conventional light bulbs with modern light bulbs. Okay, for the industrial part, one can assume that they are always trying to spend as little money as possible on the energy they use. So one can assume that this is actually quite efficient already. Actually, as I'm a chemical engineer, I see how that improvements are still possible in very many locations, but in most cases these are small optimizations that are performed. Okay, so this overall diagram gives you an impression what we are using energy for, how we are using it, how it is distributed according to the different sectors, and actually where the energy is coming from. One way to cope with the problem of energy supply that we have seen before actually is to use biomass, bioenergy. Well, you grow your plants, you grow your crops, for example, rape, or sugarcane, and then from that you produce alcohol or plant oil, and then use that after some conversion processes, usually, to as a fuel, for example, yeah? Biodiesel or pure alcohol that you add to your gasoline, possibly. So you want to cope with the possible shortage of these energy carriers by substituting them with bioenergy. Now, bioenergy has also a limiting factor, and the limiting factor is the land area. We will see that later on, and how actually bioenergy production and food production compete with each other on this single resource that they use, land area. So what I plot here is again the land area. It's again per capita for each of us in the different countries. The world average is around 19,000 square meters land area overall, but this includes all the land area. Actually, India has only very little land area per person, China significantly more already, but both significantly below world average. Africa is significantly above world average. Also America, and especially also the United States, are significantly above world average. Europe is significantly below, similar value as China. Germany actually very crowded as well, only 4,200 square meters per person, and Austria has roughly half the world average per person available. Okay, you see that this resource that is responsible for, or that allows to produce bioenergy, is very unequally distributed between the nations. Well, not only bioenergy, but of course also food. So this is a very interesting fact, actually, because this means that presumably in those nations that have larger land area available, if it is fertile, that you can produce lots of food, sell it to others, so you have a significant amount of income, and the other nations, well, they can't sell any food, so they have to concentrate on other things in their economy. But now we look also a little bit at the other areas and how they are distributed, again on global average. Well, here I plotted also the sea area, 51,700 square meters for each of us. The total land area being almost, as I said, 19,000. Of this we use agriculturally 7,000 square meters, and of that one third, 2,200 square meters, for arable land and permanent crops. Permanent crops meaning apple trees, orange trees, things like that, olive trees, whatever. And two-third of the agricultural land area is used as pastures and permanent meadows, meaning here animals are produced. 5,800 square meters are used for woods and forests. Now, the question is, I said, by relating that to the people, taking the per capita values, we get numbers that we can imagine. Of course, if you are a farmer, you directly know 7,000 square meters, a little bit less than a hectare, you can imagine how much that is. But actually, I can't. My garden isn't that big. Yeah? So I have to try to relate it to something else. And actually, this is a very interesting number, because an internationally accepted soccer field has something of the order of 7,200 to 7,400 square meters. So this more or less corresponds to a soccer field. And I use one third of the soccer field for plant-based production and two thirds of the soccer field for animal-based production of food. And a little bit less than a soccer field for forests and woods. Okay, what are we doing with this? Well, first of all, I should say, if you add these up, they don't add to this almost 19,000. Why is that so? Well, on the one hand side, there is, of course, land available or is there on the earth which is not fertile, meaning it's deserts and it's permafrost regions. This makes up roughly 30% of the land area that we have available. You can't use that. It's useless, at least today. We don't know. If climate changes, we don't know what will happen with that. On the other hand side, something of the order of 10% is used up by the direct utilization by humans, meaning housing, streets, industry. Yeah, so you have to also account for that. And then these numbers sum up to this almost 19,000 square meters per person for each of us. And I've shown before in the different nations, the available land area differs quite significantly. Now the question is, what do we do with that? And this is given here. It's again expressed in kilograms per capita in day. We produce on that 2.26 kilograms of plant-based food, 520 grams animal-based foods, we have 140 grams of other utilization of plants, meaning biodiesel, bioethanol as a fuel, for example, 160 grams of cardboard and paper, and around 600 grams of wood and wood products. Furniture, for example, or for building, for construction, all this is included in here. Overall, we have 3.55 kilograms that we produce on the land area and utilize. And actually, if we took the number before, we saw we have 7,000 square meters for the agricultural area, 5,800. This together is almost 13,000. And so it's quite a significant amount of these overall available 19,000 square meters per capita that we have available. And the rest, of course, we have also those that can't be used and those that we want to save, actually, to have nature live in there. For example, in Brazil also, we have regions that we don't want to touch, actually. So we produce this actually on a significant amount of the land area available. One can hardly increase the land area, so the question is, can one increase that? And we want to compare this now to the fossil resources that we are using. There we saw that we use 5.6 kilograms per capita a day, meaning it's 1.5 times as much as we produce sustainably. So we are using up those resources that we cannot renew, that are not renewable, 1.5 times as much as we use the renewable resources. This means, of course, on the other hand side, if you want to substitute these fossil energy carriers by something else, this is quite a significant effort. If you see that overall we produce roughly 10 kilograms or so of material, either fossil or renewable, these numbers here, and we want to replace more than half of that by some new technology, this means the overall economy, so to speak, then this is really a very, very significant effort that we have to take. Now the question is, can we detail this a little bit more, especially concerning the food? And there I want to look a little bit more into detail. And here we see now the kilocalories per capita and day for different, well, crops that are grown on the land area, on the farmland. I should first relate that to something, the numbers that we see here. United Nations says that we need roughly 2,000 to 2,500 kilocalories per capita and day for a healthy nutrition. And this only accounts for the energy content, not for the nutrients, it's just the energy. But let's stick with that for the moment. And there we see that we have corn, 1,000, wheat, almost 800, rice, almost 700, soybeans, 300, and so on. And you see there are some which are significantly contributing to the overall calories production worldwide. This is our worldwide numbers, worldwide average numbers again. Overall, we produce more than 4,000 kilocalories per capita a day, way enough for our nutrition. Now, from this, we take something as feed, and that's actually quite a significant fraction. We also take something to produce bioenergy. And then, what is remaining after all that? We wind up with 2,300 kilocalories plant-based products really supplied to the people as food. And 500 kilocalories per capita and day animal-based food for the people. That's really what's handed to the shops, more or less. And that is then being sold or of course there also some waste occurs. Overall, it's 2,831 kilocalories per capita and day. Actually, these numbers are from 2009. So we, from what we produce on the plant area, we lose quite a significant amount of the kilocalories upon the production of other things, and mainly based on for the animal-based food. One clearly has to say that. And we don't only use the feed fraction of this, but we also use the additional land area. Two-thirds of the agricultural land area are used to feed animals. Yeah? Meadows, for example. So, and with that, we produce only 500 kilocalories per capita on a global average level. How much could we produce on the other hand side? And this is now given per square meter, kilocalories per square meter and year. And we see different fruits, and it's given for Germany. Why did I choose Germany? Well, on the one hand side, there are enough data and good data available. This is one reason. But the second reason is that Germany has pretty good climate situation. On the one hand side, there is not enough sunlight so that you have good crop production. On the other hand side, you have enough water. That is, rainfall in many areas is fully sufficient for the watering of the plants. So these are good conditions, of course. And there we see that per square meter we reach numbers of kilocalories per square meter and day and year. We see as much as we need for one day of our consumption. Now, if we grow only these first things and only regarding energy content, you see, then of course we would have enough per square meter to supply us food for one day. That is, talking only about energy, we would need one square meter for each day that we for our food. And of course, since we have 365 days per year, we would need for the entire year 365 square meters if we would just live on tomatoes, corn, potatoes, and wheat. But actually, that's not a healthy diet. We would mix that with the other vegetables that we have available. And because of that, and since they are less efficient in calories production, we need more than this 365 square meters for each of us. And you can estimate that, say, 1,000 or 1,500 square meters for each of us would be fully sufficient to supply us with plant-based nutrition. And actually, these are numbers that are really realistic. 1,500 square meters, even on a world average, meaning also some not so fertile land area, would be sufficient if you look at the overall numbers. So now the question is, how is that then distributed? And I again want to dwell a little bit on this ratio between plant-based and animal-based nutrition and focus a little bit more on that. So we produce 4,200 kilocalories per day, and of those, only 2,330 kilocalories are winding up at the consumer. On the other hand side, the rest leads to 500 kilocalories per day and capita animal-based food. And what I just mentioned before already is one-third of the land area is used for producing this, and two-thirds plus a significant amount of this plant-based material is then used to produce only 500 kilocalories per capita and day. Of course, this on one hand side, one sees animal-based food is not very efficient. Of course, this is not a really fair comparison, because the pastures and the permanent meadows, they are not as fertile land as we usually have in arable land and for permanent crops. So there is a distinction in the available land area and the fertility of the land, of the ground, so to speak, of the soil. So one cannot really compare that one to one. But nevertheless, of course, one could also use those things to grow certain plants without problem. There is growing something, apparently. So animal-based nutrition is obviously not very efficient. And I want to show this really graphically so that we can see that directly. If you look at that first, in the first line, so to speak, we get the land area, 2,200 square meters arable land and permanent crops, and these 4,800 square meters of pastures and permanent meadows. So this gives us the ratio, the relation between the land areas that we use for plant-based and for animal-based food production. On this, we then grow, and now it goes to the lower scale here, more than 4,200 and something kilocalories per capita and per year, per day. So this corresponds to what we get from that per day. It's the food, it's things from plants that we use to manufacture food, that's this fraction. Then other means that we are using it as bioenergy, for example, a little bit seed, a little bit waste. Actually, at this step, it's a very small fraction which is wasted, and a significant amount that we use as feed. So this feed, together with all this land area, is then used to produce this little animal-based calories. So even what we feed is more than we get animal-based calories, and this does not include what we get here, what we have here, as a pastures and permanent meadows to feed the animals as well. And then you see in the end the relation between the plant-based and the animal-based food supply. This hopefully makes it very clear that the animal-based food production is extremely inefficient. How the relation between animal and plant-based nutrition looks like on a worldwide scale is shown here. This is the nutrition in kilocalories per capita and day again versus the population. We have seen a similar diagram already for the energy consumption. And this is now for the food, the nutrition, the food consumption. Again, horizontal axis times the vertical axis corresponds to the overall amount of the kilocalories used in the entire nation. The country. And it's discriminated between the plant-based, which is shown in blue, and in red, the animal-based nutrition. And we see different things. On the one hand side, we see that, well, many of the nations have on the average more than the 2,000 kilocalories per day. Some are a little bit below that, but that's is a very rare occasion, actually. Most of them lie above 2,000, and quite a number also be above 2,500. So that's sufficient in general, and some are even producing significantly more and hopefully exporting that. But actually that's not the case. Yeah, the export goes the other way around actually. China is exporting lots of food to Europe, for example. What we also see is that the ratio between animal and plant-based nutrition differs significantly between different nations. I don't know which bar corresponds to which nation here, but you see that it can be as little or as much that is the animal-based nutrition over here. And one can say also these things are changing, of course. In China, for example, we will see later, the animal-based fraction of calories used up per day is significantly increasing during the last decades. So what we see is that many countries are around where the diet is very much plant-based, and they have enough food available. So these are the richer nations, they have lots of food, and there we have also high plant-based nutrition, or high fraction of plant-based nutrition. So this is more or less a difference in culture, sometimes in religion, between the different countries that one eat more animal-based products and one eat less animal-based products. It's not a question of general nutritional demands by the human body or so. With that, I would like to come to an end. And what we have seen in this video is, on the one hand side, that we can get quantitative values and that we can use them to generate the per capita values. And that are now values that we can imagine. We can compare to things of our everyday life. We know how much 5.6 kilograms of fossil resources are. We can imagine how much that is. We can imagine how much 3.55 kilograms of renewable raw material are that we use. Yeah, and we can even imagine the 2 tons of fossil resources per year that we use, or even the reserves that we have for coal, for example, 8 wagons of coal, 8 small wagons of coal. And we have also seen on this quantitative basis that we need 1.5 times what we use as renewable material, we use up as fossil raw material, meaning that we are really excessively using the fossil raw materials that we have, and even though they are not renewable. And I've also shown in the end that just by looking at the numbers, you directly see that the animal-based food is a very excessive use of the resources that we have, the land area especially that we have available. With that, I've shown a little bit where we are today. And based on that, we will set up the balances in the next presentations the next videos going for fossil energies in the first step, then looking what does that to the atmosphere, how do we use the land area, nutrition, we have discussed that already, and then finally showing some options for the future. I hope you will join me again in the next video on the balances as guides towards a sustainable future. I would be happy if you join me again. Thank you very much.